Did you know that different parts of your brain have different jobs or functions that they're in charge of doing? Maybe you did already know that. But let me give you a really cool example that I read about a few years ago. I read a book called You Don't Look Like Anyone That I Know. It's by an author named Heather Sellers, and Heather Sellers has a rare disorder called prosopagnosia, or face blindness. And she tells the story of running up to this man in the airport, her husband, and wrapping her arms around her husband and saying hello. And then she realizes it wasn't actually her husband. Now, how could she have made that mistake? Well, it turns out there's a certain part of our brain, and it's here in the cerebrum, and the whole purpose of that little section right there is to recognize faces. Now, she can still see faces and see different parts of faces, but you can't recognize people by their face, which is weird to think about. But if you think about it like hands, for example, if you saw this hand out of context, you probably wouldn't be able to say, oh yeah, that's the hand that belongs to that guy that does the science videos on YouTube. But maybe you could if you saw my face. So that region of Heather Sellers' brain is underdeveloped, and she never gained the ability to recognize people by their face. She would recognize people in other ways, by the way that they walked or what they would wear, or just the context in which she would see the person. But that's an example of a certain region of her brain doing something very specific. And that's kind of the whole theme of this lesson. Different parts of your brain do different things, and there's a lot of different parts. So let's jump to the whiteboard and take a look at some of the main parts and some of their primary functions. One of the first things that you'll notice is that there's lots of folds and creases. These folds are called gyri, or gyrus for singular. So here's a gyrus, here would be a gyrus, there's a gyrus, everywhere a gyrus. And the little indentations between the gyri are called sulci, or sulcus for singular. So here's a sulcus, and I can run my finger up along that sulcus. So gyri are the folds, and sulci are the indentations into the brain between the folds. The sulci and the gyri are found on the cerebrum, which is this outer main part of the brain and the biggest part of the brain. The cerebrum has two hemispheres. We have a right hemisphere and then a left hemisphere. This is my right, this is my left. And in this video, we're gonna look at the lobes of the cerebrum in one diagram. And then we're going to look at a sagittal cross-section in another diagram and look at some of the internal structures of the brain. So the brain that I'm drawing right now, we're looking from the side, or a lateral view of the brain. The left part of the diagram is the anterior side, or front of the brain, and the right side is the posterior, or back part of the brain. And I've drawn an eyeball here to help you see which side is the front. Get it? To help you see? I didn't intend that pun, but I'll take it. This front lobe, or frontal lobe, has a lot of functions. One function is executive functioning. Executive function is things like planning, organizing, or self-monitoring during a task. That's all taking place in your front lobe. So if you get disorganized, say, come on, frontal lobe, what are you doing to me here? It's in charge of your personality. Really, a lot of what makes you you is happening up here in the frontal lobe. And it's involved in higher order thinking and decision making. So whenever you do a complicated math problem or have an important life decision to make, you're using your frontal lobe of your cerebrum to make those decisions. One more function of the frontal lobe is it's the primary site of motor control. When I say motor control, I'm talking about movement. Think motor and movement. On the posterior side of the frontal lobe, we have a special section of the brain called the motor cortex, or motor strip. And all of your motor movements are going to be originating from that part of the brain and sending signals down throughout the spinal cord into your muscles to tell them to move. Just posterior to the frontal lobe is the parietal lobe, which is on the top or superior part of the brain. Whereas the frontal lobe, as one of its functions, was movement and control of movement, the parietal lobe is kind of the opposite. It's about information coming in or processing sensory information. That could be things like feeling hot or cold, touch sensation, proprioception, which is a fancy term for detecting where our body parts are located. For example, I can tell where my hands are right now, even though I can't see my hands. That's an example of proprioception. Or kinesthesia, which is the detection of the motions of your body. So most sensory information is going to be processed by the parietal lobe, but also interpreted by the parietal lobe. We call those interpretations perception. So not only does it receive sensory information, but it also processes that and interprets it or perceives it. That's our perception. A good example of that might be feeling something brush my arm. If I already know my wife is in the room with me and I feel something brush my arm, I'm gonna perceive that touch as, oh, that's just my wife. Or if I'm alone, I may perceive that touch as, oh, there's a bug crawling on me, get the off me. So those would be two perceptions of the same sensory information that our brain brought in. And finally, the parietal lobe deals with spatial reasoning. So being able to process things in three dimensions or kind of geometric reasoning or moving things around, that's all spatial reasoning. The most posterior lobe is called the occipital lobe, and it's got one primary function. We have a whole lobe for this, which is the processing of visual information, which is kind of weird that it's in the occipital lobe because that's about as far from our eyes as we can get. Occipital back here, and our eyes are up here. But information from our eyes is sent directly back to the occipital lobe. There we interpret that information and process it and decide what to do with it. An interesting fact about this is that our eyes actually send information across to the opposite sides of our occipital lobe. So the left occipital lobe processes what the right eye sees, and the right occipital lobe processes what the left eye sees. And in fact, that's the same thing for our motor cortex. When you move your right arm, that's a signal being sent from the left hemisphere of your brain. And when you move your left arm, that's a signal being sent from the right hemisphere of your brain. So if you ever get things backwards, hey, that's just how your brains are arranged. The fourth and final lobe is the temporal lobe, which is located on the lateral side of your head, right where your temples are. Temporal lobe. And that lobe is also right next to your ear, and it's going to process auditory information. So whenever you listen to your favorite song, that's being processed by your temporal lobe. Your temporal lobe also processes olfactory information, which is your sense of smell. So hearing and smell are both processed in the temporal lobe. And the third really important function of the temporal lobe is the processing and developing of memory. For many of us, music and also smells can conjure up memories of things that we've experienced pretty strongly. And it's no coincidence that all of those functions, memory, auditory processing, and olfactory or smell processing, all takes place in the same lobe of the cerebrum. When we talk about the lobes of the cerebrum, we're usually talking about the outer or superficial part of this called the cerebral cortex. But I want to dive a little bit into two structures of the limbic system, which are in the temporal lobe, but they're located much deeper inside the brain. The limbic system is associated with the processing of emotion, but it's also strongly tied to memory. So here's two structures I want to tell you about that are in the temporal lobe, in the limbic system, a little bit deeper in the brain. And those are the amygdala and the hippocampus. When I think of the amygdala, I think of anxiety and fear, but it also deals with the processing of memory. So whenever you feel strong anxiety and fear, a lot of times we'll remember those experiences, and that's all processed and encoded by the amygdala. And in fact, they've done experiments in mice where they destroyed the amygdala, and those mice are no longer fearful of their environment. Now, before you go out and destroy your amygdala, fear is important. We need to be afraid of things sometimes. Another structure that's part of the limbic system in the temporal lobe is called the hippocampus. The hippocampus takes your short-term memory and stores it as long-term memory. For example, the first time that you hear a phone number, you're not going to be able to remember that more than just a few seconds. But if you have to type in that phone number multiple times, your hippocampus will start to encode that into a long-term memory that you can then recall on whenever you need to. And there's other structures in the limbic system, but those are two of the most well-known ones. This next structure is not part of the cerebrum. Remember, cerebrum is the four lobes we talked about. This fifth structure is called the cerebellum, and it literally means little brain. It's located on the posterior side of the head and inferior to the cerebrum. The cerebellum is going to be all about coordinating your movements. I like to use the example of learning how to throw a ball for the first time. The first time you throw a ball, it probably looks something like this. But after you practice throwing a ball and you learn how to do it really well, suddenly you'll have a nice, smooth movement. Your cerebellum on that posterior part of your brain is responsible for coordinating those complex movements, along with the motor strip that we talked about earlier. The cerebellum also takes sensory information and combines that with the motor cortex in order to refine our complex movements. A good example of that is if you're walking on uneven terrain, you have to take the sensory information, the unevenness of the ground that you're walking on, and still coordinate your walking. Their cerebellum is responsible for that. The cerebellum is also involved in posture and balance. For the record, my bad balance was not due to a disorder of the cerebellum, but due to the fact that I have no control over my leg muscles. Also, if you laughed at a guy falling out of a wheelchair, shame on you. Just kidding, it's okay if you laughed. But I bet you don't forget that the cerebellum is in charge of balance now. So again, the cerebellum is in charge of the coordination of movement, as well as balance, and things like muscle memory. Muscle memory is really an inaccurate term, though. Your muscles don't really remember anything. It's your brain, your cerebellum in specific, that's remembering those complex movements and allowing you to do them over and over again. At the very bottom, we have the spinal cord, which is going to take information from the brain and send it down throughout the rest of our body through our nerves. Two more well-known structures of the cerebrum are involved in interpreting speech and forming speech. In the frontal lobe, we have an area called Broca's area. And Broca's area is where all of our speech patterns are formed. So all of the complex movements you do with your tongue and mouth in order to form words and sounds, that's all being controlled by Broca's area. If somebody has a stutter or a delay in speaking, a lot of times that can be tied back to a disorder of Broca's area. Now for the interpretation of speech or learning of language, we have something called Wernicke's area. Wernicke's area is in the parietal lobe, and it's all about understanding speech and the sounds that we hear. So Broca's area, the formation of speech, and Wernicke's area, the processing or understanding of speech that we hear. Let's go back through all of this one more time. Pause the video and see if you can identify the four lobes of the cerebrum, also the other two structures on this diagram, and also say what their functions are. First, we have the frontal lobe, which is going to control higher order thinking, executive functioning skills like planning and organizing, your personality, problem solving, and controlling all of your movements because of the motor cortex. Posterior to that, we have the parietal lobe, which is involved in processing sensory information and also spatial reasoning. The most posterior lobe is the occipital lobe, which is in charge of processing visual information. We have the temporal lobes, which are located on the sides or laterally on the brain, and those are involved in the processing of auditory information, olfactory or smell information, and also the processing of memory. And we talked about how the amygdala processes anxiety and fear and makes memories from that, and the hippocampus, which takes short-term memories and converts them into long-term memories. Inferior and posterior to this, we have the cerebellum, which is in control of coordination of movement, as well as balance and posture, and we have the spinal cord there at the bottom. That was a lot of different structures, but luckily, you have your own brain to help you remember them. See what I did there? Now, there's a bunch of internal structures in the brain as well, and I cover those in part two of this video, which you can click right here. Part two of this video is going to cover things like the hypothalamus and thalamus, the brain stem, the pineal gland, the pituitary gland, and other internal structures of the brain. So hopefully, we'll see you in part two. What do you think, Terry? Should we learn about the other structures of the brain? Oh, yeah.